Please see the link in the description to download a worksheet for this video. Experiments can be dangerous. If you are a child, never do experiments unless your parent, guardian, or adult educator says it's all right and is there with you the whole time. This fluid is modeled after rocket fuel that NASA invented. When we put it over a magnet, the oil shows part of the magnet's force field. We'll look at this more closely in a moment, but first, let's learn the basics about magnets. These are examples of permanent magnets, regardless of the shape, size, or the material they're made with. All magnets have a north pole and a south pole. If the magnet has paint or tape, then the north pole is typically painted red. When the opposite poles of magnets are close to each other, the magnets will attract each other. That means they will try to get closer. When the same poles are close to each other, the magnets will repel each other. That means the magnets will push each other away. If we have both of the north poles of these magnets facing each other, the magnets will push against each other, so the top one will seem to float in midair. We call this magnetic levitation. This is the same idea behind maglev trains that use magnetic levitation to raise the trains above the tracks so they can go very fast. Magnets can attract some materials that are not magnets. When this happens, such as with these paper clips, both poles of the magnet attract the other material. This magnet has no paint on it, but it works just like other magnets. Can you predict which of these common objects the magnet will attract? Wood, leaf, paper, wooden blocks, styrofoam, rubber products, cotton products, silk, glass, ceramic, steel toy, yes. Candle, plastic, steel tool, yes. Metal binder, yes. Steel bolt, yes. Steel nut, yes. Magnet, yes. Titanium bolt, no. Aluminum nut, no. Stainless steel fork, no. Aluminum can, no. This experiment tells us that magnets only attract household items that are made of metal. But magnets do not attract all items made of metal. This is an electric magnet connected to a crane. Unlike the permanent magnets that we showed earlier, an electric magnet can be turned off and on with a switch. When the crane operator wants to pick up metal, the operator turns the magnet on. When the operator wants to drop the metal, the operator turns the magnet off. We've made a small version to demonstrate how it can be used. The electric magnet hangs from a cable on the crane and is connected to a switch and a power supply. When the switch is activated, the magnet turns on, and it will lift up metals that can be attracted by magnets. When the switch is deactivated, the magnet turns off and the metal will drop. Let's say this front loader just dumped these items here. There is a rubber band, a piece of styrofoam, a steel bolt, a piece of glass, a piece of cardboard, and a piece of plastic. When we turn on the magnet, which item or items do you think the electric magnet will lift? The electric magnet only attracted the steel bolt. We'll move the magnet to a different location, then turn the magnet off, and the bolt drops. As with the real crane, we've separated some metal from a pile of other items. Magnets can move objects without touching or contacting them, so we call the magnetic force a non-contact force. The strength of a magnetic force depends on two things: how powerful the magnet is and the distance from the magnet. This bar-shaped magnet is the same one we used in our earlier experiment. This one is identical, but we put red tape on its north pole. This magnet's magnetic force is too weak to lift this stack of weights. We can increase the magnetic force by using a stronger magnet. Or, we can increase the magnetic force by stacking two low power magnets with their north poles facing the same direction. Let's do an experiment to see how the strength of a magnetic field changes based on its distance to the magnet. If we separate these low-power magnets from the metal hook using one wooden stick, the magnetic force is too weak to lift the weights. But if we have no separation, then the magnetic force is large enough to lift the weights. If we separate this medium-power magnet from the hook with two wooden sticks, then the magnetic force is too weak. But if we use just one stick, and the force is large enough. Finally, if we separate this high-power magnet from the hook with three wooden sticks, the magnetic force is too weak. But if we separate it by two wooden sticks, then the magnetic force is high enough. We've mounted a magnet on this cart, and we'll hold this magnet with its north pole facing the cart, so the two magnets will repel each other. From three blocks away, the magnetic force is very weak. From two blocks away, the magnetic force is medium. From one block away, the magnetic force is high. Magnets exert their force through fields. We can see where some of a magnetic field is by putting a board over a magnet, then sprinkling tiny pieces of iron around it. The force is greatest near the magnet. These lines are called magnetic field lines. Using paper shows the magnetic fields in just two dimensions. This oil is called ferrofluid and is the same one we showed earlier. This allows us to see some of a magnetic field in three dimensions. The oil is attracted to the magnet's poles, so forms these flexible, soft spike shapes as it gets closer to the magnet. Both the north and the south poles form these shapes. When we put the magnet on its side, you can see the oil makes spikes only near the poles. Magnets play a huge role in modern technology. We can think of magnets as the key link between the energy of movement and the energy inside electricity. For example, giant magnets inside this wind turbine convert the motion of the blades into electricity that connects to the electrical outlets in our walls. If we plug a fan into the outlet, magnets in the electric motor convert the electricity into motion, so the blades move. The machinery that makes windmills and fans are nearly identical to each other, because both use magnets as the link between electrical energy and motion energy. They are like two sides of the same coin. Here's a summary of this introductory video on magnets. Please pause this video to read this if you wish. If you're interested in practice tests that are similar to state exams, but with detailed, colorful explanations for each answer, then please see our apps in the App Store. Many of these are free and none expire or limit their function. Since we only make educational products for children, none of our apps have third-party advertising, in-app purchasing, or connect to the internet. Please subscribe if you'd like to be notified of future educational videos we make. Thanks for your attention.